As one officer put it, to us, America's superiority in space is why the 170-pound US solider in Afghanistan is so much more lethal than the 170-pound enemy soldier he faces. The American soldier can look down at a screen and see the enemy on the other side of the mountain. The US military has so much more information than its adversaries, provided by satellites, GPS, and other sophisticated systems. Why this matters, a senior military officer summed it up in his briefing. Our adversaries see space as a potential warfighting domain, and while Russia has always understood the importance of space, it's really China that's growing incredibly fast. What's next? America's adversaries are rapidly developing their military space capabilities. China is determined to dominate space, and is investing gobsmacking amounts of money to get the edge on the US. In 2007, China tested its first anti-satellite weapon, and its military space capabilities have grown substantially since then. These concerns will grow ever louder as the Pentagon fights for a larger budget. Members of Congress with histories of mistreating women should be extremely nervous. Major outlets, including CNN, are dedicating substantial newsroom resources to investigating sexual harassment allegations against numerous lawmakers. A Republican source told me HES gotten calls from well-known DC reporters who are gathering stories about sleazy members. Bottom line, Democratic Sen. Al Franken is the very tip of the congressional iceberg. Many more stories are coming, and we wouldn't be surprised if they end several careers. Why this matters, the federal courts affect almost every area of policy: gun rights, presidential executive orders like Trump's travel ban, social policy issues like abortion and freedom of religion, and tensions between regulation, litigation, and private enterprise. McConnell's judges, who passed through a well-funded and organized conservative pipeline, will shape the U.S. over many decades in ways we can't yet imagine. Smart Democrats are deeply concerned about this trend, and understand that these lifetime judicial appointments will have a much greater impact on the future direction of this country than any short-term spending deal or policy. Example: this will be the single most important legacy of the Trump administration. Sen. Chris Coons, a Delaware Democrat and member of the Senate Judiciary Committee, told Business Insider. If conservatives have their way, he said, the Senate would put judges on circuit courts all over the country, district courts all over the country, that will, given the youth and conservatism, will have a significant impact on the shape and trajectory of American law for decades. As Congress becomes more and more dysfunctional, and more power accrues to the executive branch, it's the judges who increasingly decide policy. It wasn't Congress that blocked Trump's travel bans. It was judges in states like Hawaii and Maryland. Inside McConnell's head, Leonard Leo, a top outside advisor on judicial appointments for President Trump and Republican leaders, told me McConnell places an enormously high priority on the confirmation of judges and has throughout his career. His thinking behind it is that the federal judiciary has an enormous impact on the future direction of our country in ways that many pieces of legislation and public policy initiatives don't. Two turkeys arrived in D.C. today ahead of the 70th annual turkey pardon. According to the White House, the two turkeys were raised in western Minnesota, and after the pardon will join turkeys pardoned by Obama at Virginia Tech's Gobbler's Rest exhibit. They will be staying in style at the Willard Hotel, as is tradition. President Barack Obama, with his nephews Aaron Robinson and Austin Robinson, and National Turkey Federation Chairman John Riecks. Photo: Manuel Balche Senyeterap. President Bush lets children from Campfire USA pet May, the national Thanksgiving turkey, as he pardons the bird. Photo: Gerald Herbert at President Clinton admires a 45-pound turkey in the Rose Garden of the White House. Photo: Doug Mills at Goldstone. First of all, if Russian intelligence had used me in some way, as people perceive but which I don't believe, then they'll know I don't know anything. If Russian intelligence HASNT used me, but are intelligent, they will equally know I don't know anything, and this is all nonsense. Was he part of a Russian plot? When people said that, I thought it was the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard. That doesn't mean that maybe they're WASNT, any Russian interference, a Trump campaign collusion in other ways. I don't know, but I'm sure I WASNT part of it. The interview took place in Southeast Asia, where Sherwell is based and where Goldstone has been traveling and trying to avoid the spotlight. Quick refresher: June 3, 2016, Goldstone emails Trump Jr. saying the Crown Prosecutor of Russia wants to provide information that would incriminate Hillary and her dealings with Russia and would be very useful to your father as part of Russia and its government's support for Mr. Trump. Trump Jr. replies, "If it's what you say it is, I love it." June 9, 2016. Meeting with Kremlin-linked lawyer Natalia Veselnitskaya takes place at Trump Tower. Trump Jr., Manafort and Kushner attend. July 8, 2017. NY Times reports that the meeting took place. July 11, 2017. Trump Jr. publishes his emails with Goldstone. Goldstone on how the meeting came together. He says client Emina Galarov, a Russian singer and the son of an oligarch, called him wanting him to arrange the meeting. He puffed up the language Galarov gave him and sent it in a message to Trump Jr. All I had to do was facilitate a meeting, he said, after which I walk away from it and whatever comes of it, thank you very much. I remember specifically saying to Emin, do you know, we probably should not get involved in this. It's politics, it's Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump. Neither of us have any experience in this world. I should have listened to that little voice in my head. But I never thought in a million years that an email I wrote in about 3 minutes to Don Jr. would be examined by the world. Many times over, I just needed to get to him to respond. I could have said that the Russian attorney believes she found a black hole, or believes Santa is real. It didn't really matter. So when he replied, if it's what you say it is, I love it, I just thought my teaser had worked. Goldstone on the meeting, I believed that she practiced a classic bait on itch. She got in there on one pretext and really wanted to discuss something else. It was vague, generic nonsense. Don Jr. ended it by telling her that she should be addressing her concerns to the Obama administration, because they were the ones in power. Goldstone on Goldstone. So when people ask why some music publicist was involved in all this, well, I was always the conduit, the Mr. Go-To, between the Agalarovs and the Trumps. If I'm guilty of anything, and I hate the word guilty, it's hyping the message and going the extra mile for my clients. Using hot-button language to puff up the information I had been given. I didn't make up the details, I just made them sound more interesting. I believe Trump Jr. acted like your son and not like someone who was versed in the world of politics. The campaign chairman, Manafort, was sitting there, so shouldn't he have said to him, we can't have this meeting? Should Don Jr. have sent this over to the FBI when I sent the email? And should they have said to me, who is this woman and what did she know? Yes, probably. Did he? No. So, you know what, I think he has already apologized. And I can apologize in some way for having sent the email in the first place. Bonus, on the Trump-Russia dossier, I can't comment about the contents of the Steele dossier, but I can tell you that there were only a few hours during a very busy schedule when Trump was back in his room at the Ritz-Carlton. Goldstone, who was with Trump for most of the trip, says, what's next? Goldstone has agreed to meet with Robert Mueller's team and congressional investigators. No date has been set for those meetings, and he's not under subpoena. Goldstone says he is writing a book. The title, Useful Idiot: How an Email Trumped My Life. President Trump fired back at LaVerBall, father of one of the three UCLA basketball players arrested in China, after Ball suggested Trump was overstating his involvement. Go deeper: how LaVerBall has used Trump's playbook and Trump's deals that brought Americans home. Mulvaney said on NBC's Meet the Press that Trump doesn't know who to believe, and thinks that the voters of Alabama should decide. Shortz said on ABC's This Week that the president has expressed his concern about the allegations against Moore. As you noted, the president has not gone down to Alabama to campaign for Roy Moore since the primary concluded. We have serious concerns about the allegations that have been made, but we also believe that all of this info is out there for the people of Alabama. Why it matters: the RNC has pulled its support from Moore and most high-ranking Republicans have repudiated him. Trump hasn't. But he has weighed in on the allegations against Democratic Sen. Al Franken. Robert Mugabe, the 93-year-old dictator who led Zimbabwe for 37 years, was expected to resign in an address to the nation Sunday afternoon. He didn't. He was removed as the leader of his party and was reportedly negotiating his resignation with military leaders earlier in the day, but said in his speech that he planned to preside over next month's party congress. Party leaders have said he'll be impeached if he doesn't resign by early next week. Emmerson Mnangagwa, who is known as a ruthless strongman and was Zimbabwe's vice president until Mugabe precipitated the coup by placing his wife next in line for the presidency, appeared poised to take control. After Mugabe's speech, it's unclear what will happen next. Key move: Broadcom's recent decision to redomicile from Singapore to the US seems to have gotten it over the final regulatory hurdles to buying California-based Brocade, as it had received antitrust approval in July but refiled in October with a US body that oversees foreign investments. It also should aid in buying Qualcomm, although first it needs to make a higher offer.